Oh. word this evening. We have two readings, Genesis 49 and Genesis 50. The death, first of all, of Jacob and then the death of Joseph. Let's look at Jacob first, Genesis 49. I'm going to read from verse 29. Genesis 49, reading from verse 29 to the end of the chapter. Then he charged them and said to them, I am to be gathered to my people. Bury me with my fathers in the cave that is in the field of Ephron the Hittite, in the cave that is in the field of Machpelah, which is before Mamre in the land of Canaan, which Abraham bought with a field of Ephron the Hittite as a possession for a burial place. There they buried Abraham and Sarah his wife. There they buried Isaac and Rebekah his wife. And there I buried Leah. The field and the cave that is there were purchased from the sons of Heth. And when Jacob had finished commanding his sons, he drew his feet up into the bed and breathed his last and was gathered to his people. And then chapter 50 and verse 22 to verse 26. So Joseph dwelt in Egypt, he and his father's household. And Joseph lived 110 years. And Joseph saw Ephraim's children to the third generation. The children of Machir, the son of Manasseh, were also brought up on Joseph's knee. And Joseph said to his brethren, I am dying, but God will surely visit you and bring you out of this land to the land of which he swore to Abraham, to Isaac, and to Jacob. Then Joseph took an oath from the children of Israel, saying, God will surely visit you, and you shall carry up my bones from here. So Joseph died, being 110 years old, and they embalmed him, and he was put in a coffin in Egypt. Amen. May God add his blessing upon his word tonight. Well, as we prepare to come and meditate upon it together, let's seek his face, let's pray. You know, that's the thing that we must do when we come to God's word, prepare our hearts to receive it. Let's pray and ask God's blessing on it. Lord, we thank you for your word. Again, we thank you the living word is open. We ask your blessing on it, Lord. We pray that we might be given understanding of it. We pray, Lord, that we might be given that faith to receive it and to believe it tonight, and that the application of it would be a blessing to our souls, not only tonight, but for many days in our lives, that we would rejoice in the hope of the gospel, that we would thank you and praise you and respond as we ought to for this marvelous truth. We thank you for the book of Genesis, Lord. We thank you for the message of the gospel contained in it. And now as we come to the end of this book, we pray you would seal it by your Holy Spirit to our hearts. Help us, O Lord, to be indeed not only believers, but believing believers, rejoicing believers, rejoicing in hope of the glory of God through Jesus Christ. O Lord, the hymn writer says, the sky, not the grave, is our goal. Help us to look up tonight and see the great hope that is set before us in Jesus Christ. Help us to have our faith strengthened and built up and increased. Prepare us, Lord, to this end. For your glory, we pray. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Well, let's turn to our text then. My text is Genesis 49 and verse 33 to start with. And then we're going to go to Genesis 50, 24 to 26. Well, let's start with Genesis 49, 33. We come to the end of this series on the gospel in Genesis. It's blessed me. I've enjoyed it, always enjoyed the Bible, but it's a thrilling truth. We've seen that Genesis, remember, is an historical book. It's a history book, but it's a book of what we would call genealogies, family trees. That's what you follow in Genesis. It's a book full of the gospel of Jesus Christ. From the very first words of Genesis to the end of this book, the gospel is there almost on every page. We've seen it over and over. The promise of a Saviour in pictures, in types, in previews. We've seen it in the lives of the people in the book of Genesis. Adam, Noah, Abraham, Isaac and Jacob, Judah, Joseph, all there picturing Christ. So I want to finish with two then. We're going to finish with Jacob and with Joseph. The book of Genesis ends with the death of Jacob and with the death of Joseph, these two men, father and son. The title of the message tonight is Dying in Faith. Now, there is no more important thing than that. Let's begin there. There is nothing more important than when you come to death, you are ready to die. You die as a believer in the Lord Jesus Christ. I've always said to people, you know, what do you do for a living? It's always a bit difficult to explain to be a pastor or a minister of the gospel. But I always say, well, I prepare people for death. A doctor, well, he wants to make you better, make you well. He deals with the body. I deal with the soul. My concern is your death and the next world, the next life. Are you ready tonight for that? Are you ready for death and you do not know when it's going to come to you? Do you ever think about death? You know, this is always considered to be a morbid subject amongst people. If you're a Christian, it's not a morbid subject. You will think about, you should think about death. The gospel itself and the hope of the gospel is totally connected to it. If you're not a Christian, well, you should think about it, but I guarantee you probably don't. You probably won't like to do so. Now, isn't that interesting? That should interest us straight away. The Christian thinks about death and the non-Christian doesn't. Those two point of views are contrasting towards death. A Christian faces death, a non-Christian won't face it, doesn't want to face it. You know, I've taken enough funerals of unbelievers and their families to see their attitude towards death. The Christian, for me, to live is Christ, to die is gain. Oh, there's a triumph in it. There's a glory in the face of death. But not the unchristian, not the unbeliever. They won't face it. They try to forget it or ignore it. Well, here we see the death of two believers. They are ready to die. They not only face it, they are prepared for death. And they make plans for it. And when they come to die, they die in faith. They die believing. So let's look at the first then, Jacob and then Joseph. Jacob died in faith. Read Genesis chapter 49 with me again. Look at verse 28. So all these are the 12 tribes of Israel. This is what their father spoke to them. He blessed them. He blessed each one according to their own blessing. The whole chapter is about Jacob blessing his sons. And then he charged them. Look at this. He charged them and said to them, I am to be gathered to my people. To paraphrase it, I'm about to die. Okay? Bury me with my fathers in the cave in the field of Ephraim the Hittite. Bury me in the land of Canaan. Bury me in the place where Abraham and Isaac are buried. Bury me there. That was the emphasis. That's what he wanted. Bury me with my fathers. Now, this is significant. You notice he goes into detail. The scripture goes into detail about this plot of land. If you've read it in Genesis, you know Abraham's paying 400, well, I say 400 pounds. And the guy says to him, look, you're rich, I'm rich. What's 400 quid between me and you? You can have it free. He says, I don't want it free. I want to pay for it. I want a title deed. I want it written down in the witness of the elders. Abraham made sure that that plot of burial land was his. But it's very significant that he quotes it now. The plot of land that Abraham bought from the Hittite. Now, what does it mean? Well, not only is Abraham and Isaac buried there, but that small piece of land was in the land of Canaan. That's the key. In the land, remember, that Jacob returned to. We've seen it in the book of Genesis after he went away from the Lord. And it was that piece of land that God, of course, promised Abraham, then repeated it with Isaac, then repeated it with Jacob. And he said it would be theirs as a memorial, he said it forever, their land. The whole of the land would be theirs. So if you like, that little plot, that little piece, was almost symbolic of a piece of freehold land bought and paid for, symbolizing the future that one day God would give them the whole land. Now that's the picture. Now do you remember his prayer when he was converted in Genesis chapter 28? Let me remind you what he said, Jacob. Let's go back to the dream and the ladder, the stairway to heaven. He dreamed, and behold, a ladder was set up on the earth, and its top reached to heaven. The angels of God were ascending, descending. Now look at this. Behold, the Lord stood above it and said, I am the Lord, the God of Abraham, your father, the God of Isaac. Here it is. The land in which you lie, I will give to you and to your descendants. Also, your descendants shall be as the dust of the earth. You shall spread abroad to the west, to the east, to the north and to the south, and in you all seeds, all families of the earth will be blessed. It was the promise that God made to Abraham, repeated to his father Isaac, now repeated to Jacob. The land in which you're lying, I'll give it to your descendants. What a glorious truth it is. And you remember when he wrestled with the Lord, when he met the Lord in Genesis chapter 32, when he returned. Look what he says. Do you remember how he holds on to the promises? Oh, God of my father Abraham, God of my father Isaac, the Lord who said to me, return to your country and to your family, and I will deal well with you. Lord, I'm not worthy of the least of your mercies. I'm not worthy of them, but you have shown your servant mercy. And he says, look, Lord, this is what he prayed. Lord, deliver me. He was afraid, of course, his brother Esau would kill him. For you, look at the promises, you have said. You said it, not me. You said, I will surely treat you well. I will make your descendants as the sand on the seashore, which cannot be numbered for multitude. He's holding on to the promises of God. Now, those are two verses to see in the context of what we're looking at tonight. So, if you like, he comes to his sons now. Here is Jacob now on his deathbed. And he comes to his sons and he basically shows them something very glorious. What is he saying to them? Well, the passage is screaming at me that Jacob still believes the promises of God. He comes right to the end of his life. He's about to die and he gives instructions to his sons. Detailed instructions. His faith did not waver in the promises of God to the end of his life. And now he comes to die and he dies believing. He says, look, I'm about to die. You take me back to the land of Canaan and you bury me there. The land that God promised to me. The land that God promised to my father and to my grandfather Abraham. You bury me there in that land. He's dying believing in the promises. He dies in faith. Now notice the very words that he uses. I think these are significant. In verse 33 of Genesis 49, look what he says. And when Jacob had finished commanding his sons, it was a command, not a request, a command. He drew his feet, it's a lovely picture of it. He drew his feet up into his bed. He breathed his last and was gathered to his people. He breathed his last. He died, took his last breath and died. Do you know how important it is to die in faith? Are you aware of how significant this is? The Bible tells us we're all going to die. We've all got that in common, haven't we? Nothing is more guaranteed than death and taxes. And we know all about taxes at the moment, don't we? We don't want to think about death, though. We worry and troubled about many things that are not important. There's nothing more important than the one thing we will not face. We won't think about it. We are going to die. Why? Why should I think about it? Well, listen, what does Jesus say? What's he going to profit a man if he gains the whole world and loses his own soul? Do you know where you're going? Do you know your eternal destiny? Do you know what's beyond death? We're a brainwashed generation that tells everybody there's nothing beyond this life. When you're dead, it's all over, it's finished. No, listen, we're not. That's not what the Bible says at all. It's appointed unto man once to die, and after that, the judgment. The judgment. Why do we die in the first place? Where does death come from? The Bible says it comes from sin. Through one man, we quoted it this morning, sin entered the world, and death through sin, and death spread to all men. So all sin. Death is a result of sin. The wages of sin is death. Do you know why people won't face death? Why they don't want to think about it? Do you know why? Do you know what the Bible says? They don't want to think about it because deep down in their hearts, it troubles them. It does. That's why death is so important. Listen, there's one thing that's certain. We're going to depart this world. Our life is going to come to an end. Have you considered it? Have you considered what will happen at the moment of death and beyond it? Why do people not want to face it? Let me tell you what the Bible says. Fear. Fear. They're afraid. Oh, it's true. The Bible says it in Hebrews chapter 2. Inasmuch then as the children are partaken of flesh and blood, he himself likewise shared in the same. Christ became a man. Why? That through death, he was made a man, he was born a man, he became man in order to die. Remember that, to die. He was made lower than the angels to die. That through death, he might destroy him who had the power of death, that is the devil. You know, one of the things that God gets, doesn't he, is a lot of blame. Why does this person die and that person die? And why has God allowed this person to have cancer and that one? We don't give the blame to the proper place. Him who had the power of death, the devil. It's there in the scriptures. Listen to this. And release those who through fear of death all their lifetime were subject to bondage. The bondage of the fear of death. It's been the crippling problem of mankind. Fear of the unknown. What's beyond death? Death is a fearful thing. There's no doubt about it. But after death, what? What then? Nothing. When you're dead, you're dead. That's it. I've seen many people die. I have. And I've been with them. And I've seen them die. And I know this. As far as I can see what I've seen, people, they might live like atheists, but they don't want to die like atheists. They don't want to die like an atheist. The Bible says that we have to all face death. It's appointed unto man once to die. And after that, the judgment. Yes, death isn't the end, you see. There's a judgment. There's life beyond the grave. Jesus said, God is the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. Do you remember it? To the Sadducees that didn't believe. They believed. Not the first people, you see, to say there is no God. Not the first people to say, when you're dead, that's it. That's what the Sadducees thought. And they came up with that cock and bull story about this guy, of course, in the law. He's got to marry his wife. And she dies. He marries his brother's wife. And he dies, and he dies, and he dies. All those brothers. Which one's he going to be married to in heaven? Just joking, thinking it's all a big joke. Oh, he said, you're greatly ignorant. You don't know the scriptures of the power of God. But listen, God is the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. He's not the God of the dead. He's the God of the living. I am the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. They've been dead centuries, and yet he says, I'm not the God of the dead. I am the God of the living. There is life beyond this world. And if you die as an unbeliever, according to the scriptures, according to the Bible, you will die in your sins. Look at Jesus talking to the religious leaders. He warned them. He told them. He pleaded with them. You will die in your sins if you're not careful. And if you die in your sins, you die unforgiven. And if you die unforgiven, you die to face the judgment for your sin. You die as an unbeliever is a terrible, terrible thing. Because after death is judgment, and after judgment is hell. Forever. Eternally, eternally condemned. And these shall go away into everlasting judgment, condemnation. That's what hell is. That's why Christ came into the world. That's the purpose of the gospel. If you don't like this stuff, well, you can't sanitize the gospel. Jesus became a man in order to die our death. God so loved the world, he gave his only begotten son, that whoever believes in him, they wouldn't perish. They wouldn't be perishing in judgment forever in hell under condemnation, but have everlasting life. And John 3:17, God sent his son into the world not to condemn the world. The world was already condemned. Not that the world would be condemned, that the world would be saved through him. That they might be saved. Saved, rescued from the eternal consequences of death. Rescued itself from this pain of death, the awful terror of death. Jesus talks about death in such poignant ways. And he warns the people about what it means to die in unbelief. It is to die in your sin. And the believer, well, he tells you, you'll never die. And yet we are going to die. Jacob died, Joseph died, but not really. They'd already passed from death into life. They were gathered to their fathers. They were carried by the angels into heaven. They had salvation. They had everlasting life through faith in Jesus Christ. The hymn writer puts it like this: he who dies believing dies safely, safely through his love. To die in faith is a glorious thing. Oh, I could tell you stories. I'd keep you here all night. About people I've been with. I've seen things you wouldn't believe. I've been with believers who had the weakest faith, who died the most glorious death. Angels present, the glory of the Lord filling the hospital room, and they being ready to meet Jesus. Saved is wonderful. Salvation is wonderful. Oh, to die as a believer is to go immediately into paradise, immediately into heaven. To die as an unbeliever is to be lost and to go into outer darkness. It's unthinkable. Now look at Jacob. Look at the way he dies. Jacob finished commanding his sons. He drew his feet into bed, breathed his last, he died. I love it. And was gathered to his people. Isn't that beautiful? He's gone to be with his father, Isaac, and his grandfather, Abraham, in heaven. He's gone to be with his people, the believers. There's a lot of rubbish talked about heaven. As if everyone's going there. As if everyone's going to be there. Remember Jesus spoke about this very poignantly when he told the parable of the rich man and Lazarus. He says, the rich man died, that's all you're told, and was buried. That's it. But Lazarus the beggar, he died and was carried by the angels into the bosom of Abraham. One just died, that's it, nothing. And the other went immediately to heaven. What a picture, what a contrast, what a glorious thing. Look at Jacob, how he dies. And look at the chapter following. Let's read the chapter 50, verse 1 to 3. Look at his funeral. And Jacob fell on his father's, fell on his father's face and wept over him and kissed him. Isn't that beautiful? His dad has, he's just lost his dad. His father's just died. The father they hadn't seen for many, many years. And now they've been reunited. And there they are, they've grown together. And they've seen children and grandchildren grow up on each other's knee. And he's been a real blessing to Joseph. And now he's dead. And he falls on him and he kisses him. What a moving picture it is. He weeps over his father and he kisses Jacob's dead face, dead body. And Joseph then commanded his servants, the physicians, to embalm his father. So the physicians embalmed Israel. Israel, remember that God changed his name. The Lord changed his name. Look at this. 40 days were required for him. For such are the days required of those who are embalmed. And the Egyptians mourned for him 70 days. 40 days for a leader in Israel. And yet the Egyptians gave him 70 days. A kind of, if you like, a state funeral. Queen Elizabeth II gave this honor, remember, to Winston Churchill. She gave him a state funeral. His body lay in state for 3 days and 300,000 people filed past in 3 days. We've just seen Queen Elizabeth II's own funeral, state funeral. What a funeral it was. What a funeral you witnessed in your lifetime. You'll never see anything like it again. She was a Christian though. And she gave instructions before her death. There's no doubt about it. And she died in faith. And here Jacob, in a similar way, the scene is a world superpower of Egypt is giving a state funeral to this old guy, Jacob. And he's calling the nation to mourn for 70 days. Elizabeth II, the whole world mourned her death. What an incredible event it was. Many people heard the gospel of Jesus Christ throughout the world. Jacob died in faith. And a person who dies in faith can be a great witness, testimony to those around who see it. Many, many have been converted. The Apostle Paul himself undoubtedly was converted watching the death of Stephen, dying in faith, seeing the Lord Jesus Christ. It led to his own conversion. Jacob died in faith. Let's go to Joseph. Joseph died in faith. Chapter 50 and verse 22. Now we've seen already Joseph is a type. Joseph is another really a picture of Jesus Christ. Salvation comes through Christ, not Joseph, but he is a picture, a preview. And God promises this guy, and he promised his father, that there would be salvation, a savior would come. Through that nation, all the nations of the world would be blessed. It began with Abraham. Now look at what Joseph does in Genesis 50, verse 22. So Joseph dwelt in Egypt in his father's household, and Joseph lived 110 years. Joseph saw Ephraim, remember his son's children, to the third generation. It's a big family. Of the children of Machir, the son of Manasseh, were also brought up on Joseph's knees. Love it. And Joseph said to his brethren, I am dying, but God will surely visit you and bring you out of this land to a land which he swore to Abraham, Isaac, and to Jacob. And Joseph took an oath from the children of Israel, saying, God will surely visit you, and you shall carry my bones from here. Now listen to the last verse of Genesis. And so Joseph died, being 110 years old, and they embalmed him and put him in a coffin in Egypt. He wasn't to be buried there yet. He was to be carried there from there years to come. Now Joseph dies in faith. We're told Joseph died. You see it? He died. But he died in faith. He died like his father, Jacob. You see the same faith? Can you see the same faith? You see the same trust in the same promises? It's true faith. Jacob wants to be taken to the land of Canaan. Don't bury me here. Swear to me now, you will bury me in the land of Canaan, not here. And Joseph says the same, similar. He take my bones. It's a prophecy as well, undoubtedly. And it will be carried there into the land of Canaan. There I'll be buried there. But there's a big difference. Can you see that there's a big difference between the two? Here is a man who has great power and wealth. What do I mean? Well, he's the prince of Egypt, like Moses. He's the second in command to Pharaoh. I mean, he could have had the most incredible burial in Egypt, couldn't he? I mean, he could have had a great pomp and ceremony, a big show. He could have had a great pyramid, a great tomb. Tombs of the pharaohs. If you've been to Egypt, very lavish. He could have had one of those. No, he doesn't want that. No, he believes in something else. He believes in God's word and God's promises. He knows that he belongs to God's people, not to this pagan nation, Egypt. And he believes in the promises that God made to Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. He believes in the promises. The book of Genesis ends with the prophecy through Joseph of the book of Exodus that we see in the next page in your Bible, the book of Exodus. It's a prophesying forward of that which is to come. Now notice two times Joseph tells them this great prophecy, great promise. Joseph said, I'm dying, he says, but God will surely visit you. He'll visit you, and he'll bring you up out of this land. Remember, it's going to be 400 years later. But he will come, and he will bring you out of this land, which he swore to Abraham, to Isaac, and to my father Jacob. Then he takes an oath, like Jacob did, from the children of Israel. So they had to swear an oath. God, he says, will surely visit you, and you shall carry up my bones from here. The picture there is now, I want you to swear to me, and this is to be written down, that when the time comes, you will be taken from this land. In the future, I prophesy, you will be taken. God will fulfill his promise. Please carry my bones to the land of Canaan. Now, what a picture that is. He makes them swear an oath. Do you see it? You carry my bones from here. He dies believing. He dies in faith. He's not going to be buried in Egypt. Jacob didn't want to be buried in Egypt. Joseph, no way is he going to be buried in Egypt. Why? He doesn't want to be associated with pagan Egyptian ideas of the afterlife. Not at all. He's a believer in the true God. He's a believer in the true gospel. He's a believer in the true message of hope beyond death. He knows the true belief. Not some vain afterlife, ridiculous theory. This is real. Where there is no hope after death. He dies in hope. He dies in faith. He dies believing. The Bible is very clear. There is no hope apart from the gospel of Jesus Christ in death. No hope whatsoever. None at all. None. Zero. Notice you're told in these two verses, Jacob died. And Joseph died. Why? Because they're sinners. They're still sinners. But they're saved sinners. You see? They're saved sinners. Joseph's body, really, if you picture it, is a type of Christ. What do you mean, a type of Christ? Even the book of Exodus goes on. The gospel carries on into the next book. Some of you have been asking, are we going to look at Exodus? Well, we'll see. But oh, what a picture. Joseph is his body now is a type of Christ. In death, he's embalmed, he's put in a coffin, and he's going to be taken to the promised land. He's going to be part of this exodus, deliverance, if you will, salvation. Genesis really is pointing forward to Exodus, but it's pointing forward beyond Exodus, beyond the Old Testament to the New Testament. Can you see it? It's pointing forward to Jesus Christ. Well, let's jump forward. Let's go to the New Testament. Let's read 1 Corinthians chapter 15. Do you remember these words? 1 Corinthians chapter 15. Let me read them to you. Listen to these words. Moreover, brethren, I declare to you the gospel which I preached to you, which you also received, in which you stand, by which you are saved. Is there any other message that gives you salvation? No, this is the only message. There's no other name given whereby you must be saved. You must be saved because you're going to die. That's why you must be saved. I received this gospel and I'd preach it to you. The gospel in which you received, in which you stand, in which you, by which you are saved, if you hold fast that word which I preached to you. If you not only believe and say you believe it, but you go on trusting it. Notice the faith there is continuous. Notice the faith is not just, well, I believed years ago, I give my heart to Jesus. No, no, none of that nonsense. No, no. Unless you believed in vain. That you hold fast to it. That you believe it to the end. The Bible says he that perseveres to the end is saved. So what really matters is not that you're a believer tonight. Not that you believe in Jesus Christ tonight. What really matters is when you come to death and dying, you die believing. There'll be people who've been in this church and they've sung hymns and they've praised God and they've gone to other churches in Blackpool and then they went away. And they died unbelieving. The only thing that matters is when you come to death, you still believe. You're still holding on to the promises. Oh, listen, he says, unless you believed in vain, for I delivered to you first that which I received. It's not from me, this gospel, you see. It comes from heaven. Oh, that Christ died for our sins. Now, notice the emphasis. According to the scriptures, according to the Bible. Why do we make so much of the Bible? Because it's God's word. And without this, we just have men's ideas. And they're not going to do us any hope beyond the grave. I can't deal with, what do you think after death? What do you think? Well, I think this, I think that. Who cares what we think? Are you going to stake your eternal destiny on the ideas of men? On the philosophies of men? You need an authoritative word from heaven. You need God to tell you what is beyond this life. How do I go into eternity? And there's only one word. It's the Bible that tells you that. It tells you the way to face it. I deliver that which I have received from heaven, from God. That Christ died for our sins. This is how you face death. And that he was buried. Notice, he died and was buried. Oh, buried. And that he rose again the third day. I love it. According to the scriptures. According to the Bible. Now look what he says in verse 20. I love it. But now he says, you know, he deals with all the questions against the resurrection. All those people that say it never happened. You remember what he says? He says, if Jesus Christ hasn't died for us, if he hasn't risen from the dead, we have no hope. There is no hope. And we, the Christians who believe this, we're the most pathetic people on the planet for believing this when there is nothing. It's just a vain hope. It's just a religion, you know, created by men to give them some hope in the next world. But it's not real. If it helps you, if it gives you some comfort, great. But it's not real. Listen, if it's not real, then there is no hope. Listen to what he says. But now Christ is risen from the dead. It's true, you know. He died for our sins. He rose again and conquered the grave. He's risen from the dead and he's become the first fruits of those who have fallen asleep, those who have died in Christ. For since by man came death, by man came the resurrection of the dead. The man there is Adam, the other man is Jesus. For as in Adam all die, as in Christ all will be made alive. You remember how he ends it? Now this I say, brethren, flesh and blood can't inherit the kingdom of God, neither does corruption inherit corruption. Behold, I'll tell you a mystery. We shall not all sleep, we shall not all die, but we shall all be changed in a moment, in the twinkling of an eye, in the blink of an eye, at the last trumpet. The trumpet will sound, the dead will be raised incorruptible, and we shall be changed. Isn't that glorious? We shall be changed. We shall put off these sinful bodies and have a glorious, glorified body. A new body. For this corruptible must put on incorruption and this mortal must put on immortality. Then, when this corruptible has put on incorruption and when this mortal has put on immortality, then shall be brought to pass the saying, I love it, death is swallowed up in victory. Oh, death, where is your sting? Oh, grave, where is your victory? It's a terrible thing to lose a loved one. It's a terrible thing to stare into a grave and see a grieving family as they bury their loved one. And yet he says, oh, grave, where is your victory? How can he say that? The sting of death is sin. The strength of sin is the law. But thanks be to God who gives us the victory. Victory over death, friends. That's what matters tonight. Through our Lord Jesus Christ. Isn't it wonderful? You see, at the end of Joseph's life, at the end of Jacob's life, oh, they die believing in this. They know they're going to be gathered. They're going to be taken to heaven. They know it. They know it. Thank God that all the way through this book of Genesis, we've seen it's pointing forward to the one who would come and die for our sins. The one who would come and rise again from the dead and be our Savior. What about you then in closing? Are you ready? I mean, are you really ready? Really ready? How are you going to face death? Are you ready to face it tonight? Ready? You know what John Wesley said about the Methodists? They asked him, what's the secret of the Methodists? He said, that's easy. Our people die well. They die well. Oh, will you die well? Will you die believing? When you die, will you go immediately to heaven? That's why we began the service. Don't let your heart be troubled. You believe in God. Believe in my Father's house are many mansions. It's a big place. I'll go and prepare a place for you. And if I go and prepare a place, I'll come back. Here's death and take you to be with me. That where I am, there you may be also. But Lord, we don't know where you're going. How can we know the way? I am the way. I am the way. The only way to heaven. Nobody can come there except through me. He is the way, the truth, and the life. Those who die believing in Christ. I've seen it, friends. I'm telling you, it's true. They go immediately to heaven. Will you die in Christ? Or will you die in your sins? Will you die like Jacob? Will you die like Joseph? Will you be gathered? Not some vain hope about, oh, well, they're there now, reunited with the family. Will you be in heaven with God's people? Will you be there? According to the Bible, there's only one way to get there, and that's through faith. You've got to die believing. You've got to die believing, trusting in God's word and his promises. Let me finish with the word of God. Listen to Hebrews 11. You remember what it says? It describes what faith is. What is this faith? Faith is the substance of things hoped for, the evidence of things not seen. How about that? It's marvelous, isn't it? The substance, it's real, you see, of the things hoped for. The evidence, it's absolutely, I don't need anybody to prove it, of things not seen. You've never seen heaven. You've never seen what's beyond this grave, but faith believes it and knows it's real. We just don't hope. We don't have wishful thinking. That's not faith. Faith is not, well, I'll trust and I hope it's okay. No, that's not faith. If that's your faith, you haven't got faith. Faith is the evidence of things not seen, the substance of things hoped for. It is so real you can touch it. Now look at what he says in verse 21. By faith, you remember he goes on, by faith, he lists them all. By faith, Jacob, when he was dying, he blessed each of his sons, the sons of Joseph, and he worshipped God, leaning on the top of his staff. You see, he blessed them, but there's more in that verse, isn't there? We've seen it tonight, and he gave command for his burial, to be taken back to the land of Canaan, leaning and worshipping on his staff. He was worshipping God and preparing for his own death. By faith, he did that. What about Joseph? Next verse. By faith, Joseph, when he was dying, made mention of the departure of the children of Israel. God will surely visit you and deliver you and lead you out of this place. He made mention of the departure of Israel and gave instructions concerning his own burial, his own bones. You see, by faith, he did that. Let me close with these words. These all died in faith. That's what matters tonight. Not having received the promises, but having seen them afar off, they were assured of them. They embraced them. They confessed that they were strangers, pilgrims on the earth. For those who say such things declare plainly they seek a homeland. For truly, if they'd been called to mind the country from which they come out, they'd have had opportunity to return. But now they desire a better country. That is a heavenly country. Therefore, God is not ashamed to be called their God. For he has prepared a city for them. Amen. Let's pray. Lord, thank you for your word tonight. Thank you, Lord, that you reveal in your word that death is not the end, that there is life beyond this world, and the only thing that matters is that we die believing, and that we die to go immediately to glory. We thank you, Lord, for the victory that you have gained over death and hell. over the devil himself. And we thank you, Lord, that we have that victory through faith in our Lord Jesus Christ. Lord, help us to sing the victory tonight in closing this service. To your glory we pray. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Well, let's sing triumphantly to the Lord tonight. Christ, our hope in life and in death. Amen.
Our hope in life and death, Christ alone, Christ alone. What is our only confidence? That our souls to Him belong, who holds our days within His hand. What comes apart from His command, and what will us to the end, the love of Christ in which we stand. Oh, sing hallelujah, our hope springs eternal. Oh, sing hallelujah, now and ever we confess Christ our hope. Troubled soul, God is good, God is good. Where is His grace and goodness known? In our great Redeemer's blood, who holds our faith when fears arise, who stands above the stormy trial, who sends the waves that bring us nigh unto the shore, the rock of Christ. Oh, sing hallelujah, our hope springs eternal. Oh, sing hallelujah, now and ever we confess Christ our hope in life and death. Christ He lives, Christ He lives, and what reward will heaven bring? Everlasting life with Him, there we will rise to meet the Lord. Then sin and death will be destroyed, and we will feast in endless joy when Christ is ours forevermore.